one aspect. You can see that aspect in which that community is organizing itself, and furthermore, through the process of this organization, people are developing. And this is one of the great stories when people do go around to Venezuela and visit the areas where they have created communal councils and hear from the people who are involved in these. You just see that they've blossomed through this process, because they feel that they are in control. They are changing their circumstances. Like we could talk about that more later. There's also the other aspect is workers' councils, workers' control. Now that's a continuing struggle, but you have workers' councils and workers' control occurring in a number of factories which have been taken over by the workers, factories which in many cases went bankrupt during the various attempted coups against the Chavez government, and the workers who were owed wages, etc., took over the factories and then demanded in many cases that the state nationalize them. In some cases the state did, and established a relationship which I think was unfortunate, 51% state ownership, 49% to a cooperative of the workers who seized the factory. In other cases, the state just provided credit facilities, so you have a number of cooperatives which function supported by the state through credit facilities. And in other cases, you have 100% state-owned operations. These are still small companies which are run by workers' management. Now, in addition to those recovered factories, and there's a recovered factory movement that tries to unite all these different seized factories, you also have the state sector itself. And in the state sector itself, there has been a continuing struggle for worker management there. And in that struggle for worker management, one of the things that is happening is that it's very uneven. There are parts of the state which are very much opposed to any involvement of workers in worker decision making. There are other parts of the state where there has been a significant movement toward worker management. In particular, in the recent years, the steel industry, the major steel company, was nationalized it's in 2008, and that one, the workers in that industry, which is a company called Sidor, began to work closely with workers from a number of the other basic industries, all state-owned, in their local area, which is a region called Guayana, in the state of Bolivar. So you then have this whole process of the bans from the workers for worker management and to get rid of the management, existing management, which was opposed to, which they saw as opposed to worker involvement. Out of this pressure from below, the Minister of Labor organized workers there to create a set of work tables for the establishment of, to talk about a socialist plan for the area of Guayana. They did this had a whole series of tables talking about how they would like to organize the system. They then, at their meeting, when the work tables reported, Chavez was there. And all this was on television. I was watching on television. It was fantastic, fascinating. As the workers made their reports, from their tables, each report was more and more radical. We have to take over this, firm. We have to do this. We have to get rid of this management, and so on like that. There are all these suppliers, and companies that are using our output, which are in fact, ripping off, creaming all the profits that should be going to the state, et cetera, like that. Everybody's cheering and cheering, and Chavez is just sitting there, taking notes, not cracking a smile, no expression at all. And he gets all, they finish, and Chavez gets up and says, I've listened to you. We're going to take over this firm. We're going to take over this firm. We're going to take over this firm. We're going to get rid of this management here. We're going to like that. Well, everybody was absolutely ecstatic, and you could suddenly, the workers are cheering, and they break out and singing spontaneously and sing the national anthem. It was a fascinating thing. But, so Chavez says, all right, 2 months, I want you to go and, develop a socialist plan for the industries here. And the workers, you know, work intensely on this one, the work tables. And some of the tables came up with fascinating solutions, like how they could use the output of one center, of one, you know, one factory as input for another rather than purchasing things from the outside, et cetera, like that. Well, you know, they came up with this plan and stonewalled by the management. Absolutely stonewalled. And stonewalled by the minister. And stonewalled by the governor, who was in fact in league with the, you know, the local, you know, some people say he's in league. This is on tape, so some people say he's in league, you know, with the local mafia. He's a Chavez. This is another one of the kind of problems internally to the Chavism. So, workers are getting very upset about this, the lack of progress after they put this effort in, and, you know, Chavez calls a cabinet meeting on television and proceeds to demand a report, you know, on the socialist plan for Ayana. He gets this report from this planning minister, and then Chavez proceeds to say, what we have here, you know, is state capitalism, you know, and without workers' control, you can't have socialism. And so from this point on, then Chavez begins to push for the realization of that plan. And it's a continuing struggle. They continue to struggle. But, you know, right now, in all of these state companies, which were part of, you know, all owned by the state through a development corporation, the workers have now selected the management. They've voted for the management as to who the management will be. And they are developing plans. They are, you know, carrying through this. And Chavez looks upon this as, you know, absolutely key in the development of the model. The same thing has happened recently in the electrical industry, where the workers in the Electrical Federation were always amongst the most militant left, you know, organization of workers there, and our institute worked very closely with them, and they, you know, they complained for several years that the industry was facing a crisis, that there wasn't the proper decision-making being made by the executives of the companies, et cetera, like that, and which are state companies. And the electrical industry, in fact, ran into an enormous crisis in the last year. And the result was the creation of a Ministry of Electricity where the workers are making key decisions. And Chavez, again, points to that. Workers' decision-making is the key to succeeding in the economy, is the key to building socialism. So you have communal control, is it happening, communal councils. You have workers' councils happening, but a struggle, especially a struggle, you know, against executives and in the state system itself. And you also have a very significant focus upon needs. There was certainly a focus on needs in the sense of creating subsidized food through the state state marketing companies called the Mercal. But now the Mercal, are now increasingly under the control of the communal councils. The communal councils now are organized in the Mercal of the, you know, the sale of goods, et cetera, like that. And, you know, there's more and more distribution at extremely subsidized funds, et cetera, like that. Now, so workers' movements, community movements, focus on needs, nationalization of industry, because that's been happening as well. All of these are not simply random activities. There is, in fact, a concept of which is unifies them all. There's a theoretical framework into which these fit, and that is, you know, best exemplified by what Chavez has called the socialist triangle. And the socialist triangle, you know, not surprisingly, it's three sides, but it comes from the idea of, you know, of an organic system, of a economic system as an organic system of production, distribution, and consumption. And in the concept of the socialist triangle is social ownership of the means of production, social production organized by workers for the purpose of satisfying communal needs and communal purposes. That those are all three sides of a socialist triangle, and it is a concept of socialism in which we recognize that these sides all interact. They interact and they're interdependent. That if you don't develop one side, it infects the other sides. So, for example, if you develop you know, ownership of the means of production by the state, but don't have an orientation toward human needs, and don't have an orientation toward workers' decision-making within the workplace and communal decision-making in the workplace, what you get, you know, is something quite different from this conception, because you are infecting even the state ownership itself. Or even if you have state ownership and worker management, as they had in Yugoslavia, with the workers' councils, legally, the legal authority within the workplaces, the whole focus there was on self-interest, maximizing the income per worker within those, state-owned or socially-owned enterprises, like as in any cooperative. And what happened was, in fact, enormous breakdown of any solidarity within the society, and that infected, all the other sides of the triangle. One of the things that, the concept of the socialist triangle is a concept which is, it doesn't necessarily have to be referred to over and over as the socialist triangle, though Chavez, talked about it, in this way quite a bit in 2008. But the idea of these three sides, social ownership of the means of production, social production organized by workers, and social for the purpose of satisfying social needs are all, part of this conception of socialism, which is different from the conceptions of socialism in the 20th century, precisely because it rejects the idea of stages. It rejects the idea of now we're in this stage, then we can do these things, later we'll be in other stages and we can do other, more nicer things, nicer, et cetera, like that. This is a conception which says everything is interdependent. And if you don't develop, these other sides of the triangle, it means the old society is building and constructing the people who are living in the society, rather than creating new societies. Doesn't mean that you can create this triangle, this organic system overnight. It means you have to struggle on all three sides simultaneously. Out of that concept of the socialist triangle, I've developed what I, proposed a concept of what I call, because the Charter for Human Development. Because one of the things that is at the core of all these sides of the triangle is this focus on human development, of people developing through their capacities, developing their capacity through their own activity. You can't talk about that happening in the context of private ownership of the means of production, because it means that those who gain from people's activity are either individual capitalists, state bureaucrats, or cooperatives, or people who are, in fact, have group property rather than, property for society as a whole. So you have to, look at all these as concepts, things linked to the idea of human development. So one of the things I proposed, as a for general, discussion is the idea of a charter, three points. One, everyone has the right to share in the social heritage of human beings, an equal right to the use and benefits of the products of the social brain and the social hand in order to be able to develop his or her full potential. Now, one should note that, it's not saying, when means of production are not the only thing that we, inherit from the past activities of people. They're all the products of human knowledge. All the whole question, the access to education, et cetera, like that. Everyone has the right to share in all of that. Secondly, everyone has the right to be able to develop their full potential and capacities through democracy, participation, and protagonism in the workplace and society, a process in which these subjects of activity have the precondition of the health and education that permit them to make full use of this opportunity. So again, that's that theme of, process of development through your own activity. And thirdly, everyone has the right to live in a society in which human beings and nature can be nurtured, a society in which we can develop our full potential in communities based on cooperation and solidarity. End of quote. So, that idea of a charter for human development, which points to all of these aspects which are part of this conception of socialism for the 21st century, this idea of a socialist triangle, that points to a whole series of areas in which people can struggle within capitalism, as well as within a process where there's a conscious attempt to build socialism, within capitalism, and recognize that what links those different struggles is, in fact, a concept of human development. That the concept of human development, in fact, is a unifying core to a lot of different struggles. And, you know, one of the things I think that is absolutely essential in this respect is to see, to search for, and see the links between struggles. The struggle for workers' control, the struggle for transparency, for opening the books of companies, which is absolutely essential if you're going to talk about workers being able to run industry, to develop their capacities within the workplace itself. The struggle within communities, the whole question of local community decision making. The struggle, the linking between communities and communal councils, which is something happening, communal councils and workers' councils, something happening within Venezuela, the attempt to link up directly the communal councils and the workers' councils in the areas, where those workplaces are located. The focus on needs. One of the things I sort of develop in the book here, in the context of one of the chapters, themes in one of the chapters, the chapter which deals with production for social needs and the focus on consumption, is the need to struggle for, to oppose what capitalism does. And what capitalism does is to try to commodify everything. Everything which is not a commodify is to turn it into a commodify. Commodify health, commodify education, commodify every possible service that within the state, et cetera, like that. Well, the alternative is the struggle to decommodify, to take things which are commodities and, move away from commodity production. That's certainly something happening in sporadic places in Venezuela, a lot of local experiments on producing directly for needs. One of the aspects of moving toward free goods and free, services, like certainly, free goods and free services, is that it doesn't happen and can't happen just simply by just declaring something is free. You need to strengthen the communities to, in fact, monitor those kinds of processes. I mean, many people, certainly conservatives, often talk about the tragedy of the commons, that if you allow everything free, then what's going to happen is everyone's going to graze this is the logic of the argument, you graze your animals on the commons, and therefore everybody's grazing as much of their animals as possible on the commons area, and therefore what happens is it's overused, it's overworked, etc. Well, that's a fiction, that is used by conservatives. Historically, there is a long history, in fact, that communities always manage, their common property, that they, organize, common property. Indigenous communities have done it, for centuries. Different communities, like fishing communities do it, when they're not interfered with by the state, themselves. They manage on how to use the resource collectively, et cetera. And in fact, in Venezuela, when I was going around to certain communities, where one community where they had 60 different cooperatives functioning, and asking, how did you develop all these cooperatives, which were doing everything, the person who was sort of the secretary of the cooperatives said, well, actually, we are just building on the traditional, conceptions of this indigenous community on land, on water use. That they, in fact, were just drawing upon the traditional indigenous, communal use decision-making. Well, things like, so the idea of developing free services and free goods is all part of a process we can, moving toward human development, and certainly the struggle, for free transit, which was, I don't know whether maybe Roger remembers, I don't know who else might remember, in 1972, the NDP in Vancouver had that as one of its central themes, the whole idea of a free bus system, talked about the merits of a free bus system. That's, certainly a struggle that can be linked to the whole question of human development, the idea of expanding the commons, et cetera. So, that's basically what I wanted to sort of throw out, you know, which was this idea of focus on human development and focus on building socialism and building a struggle for socialism by, instead of looking at, you know, all these existing struggles as isolated struggles, trying to build the links between them. And I think that's one of the ideas that we were trying to sort of do in our initial discussions when, you know, I was talking with David about, you know, the idea of trying to move in the direction of something like they've been trying to do in Toronto with the establishment of a greater workers' assembly. That's what, you know, has been developed in Toronto, which goes beyond, you know, the traditional way of organizing the working class simply through trade unions, which are, after all, exist simply to protect their own members and to get benefits for their own members. But the demands of working people certainly go beyond, you know, the individual trade unions, and the idea of a workers' assembly, such as, you know, they're doing and trying to work on in Toronto, certainly goes beyond it, because it brings together, you know, workers in different industries, where it brings together people who are not organized, it brings together people who are not employed, and they struggle, they're moving to struggle on different issues, you know, such as one of their current themes is precisely free transit. So anyway, that's, you know, what I want to sort of throw open. I don't know, you know, where people want to go from there, but I think that it does open up the possibility of lots of discussion.
So. Good. Thanks very much, Mike. Yeah.